I'll second.
Motion presented, those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Moving on, old business?
Yes, I was able to vote, and it's not our date.
Oh, that was from the minutes.
Yeah. Oh, I guess I amended my mind.
And I'll second the amendment. Thank you.
We'll do another vote on the amended motion, amended. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Next item on the agenda, old business, there is none, so we're moving on to new business. Agenda item number four, proposed mitigated negative declaration of rezone and use permit. Applicant Wood.
Good evening, commissioners. As you just said, we're looking at three different actions. Approving the negative declaration that was prepared for this project, a rezone from unclassified to agriculture, and a use permit for a bed and breakfast. This is in an area that is fairly remote, downriver. On the west side of the river, it's mainly agricultural lands, and on the east side of the river, it's a mixture of ag and timbered lands. So staff prepared two different findings for approval of this. Two different recommendations. One was to go from unclassified to agriculture, and the other is to go from unclassified to ag forests. Historically, it's kind of ironic, but historically, the parcel, if you look at figure five, it's kind of interesting. When a cultural resource study was done, the archaeologist came up with this photo. But it's a photo, an aerial photo from 1947, and it shows that the parcel was quite a bit more clear than what it is today. There are other ag uses, like I said, on the west side of the river. On the east side, historically, it's been more oriented around timber. The applicant is here this evening. Do you have any questions?
The tent camp ground is definitely off the table. Thank you.
Any questions for staff, Commissioner?
So in terms of traffic, it says there's 161 average daily trips on South Fork Road. Where is that measured? Is that right near 299, or is that close to the project site?
No, it's from the junction 299 and South Fork Road.
And most of the development is between this project and 299.
Yes.
There's not much south on South Fork Road.
That's correct.
So all the, any traffic generated by this project will go past all the residences. So, since I don't think we've had this discussion before that I remember, how many trips per day would be significant, what's the threshold of significance for increasing average daily trips?
That's an excellent question, and if Rick were here, we could probably address it, but I am very weak in traffic analysis, so I can't answer that.
And do we have any estimate of how many trips the project would generate?
I think an applicant might be able to address that a little more clearly, if she knows better what her business would probably take, and we'll open the floor here.
Okay. That's all I have.
Any other technical questions or clarifications for staff, commissioners? Otherwise, we will open the public comment. This item carries a public hearing or a public comment, so anyone wishing to address the commission, including the applicant, in regards to this agenda item, please come forward, state your name for the record.
Hello, Judy Nelson and South Fork Road. So thank you for considering our request. And I think in regards to the traffic, I mean, since it is remote, and we intend to prepare food on site for the guests, we would anticipate them coming, staying for the duration of their stay. They might go out rafting or hunting or something like that, you know, and then come back. But as a rule, there's not going to be a lot of in and out during the time that somebody would be staying at the bed and breakfast. So that's what we anticipate. And, the only other comment that I would have is that according to reading the two different zonings, the ag forest versus the ag, I feel that the ag zoning is more in line with what we are trying to do. Part of what we're hoping to bring people to the bed and breakfast for is for permaculture classes and just like as a demonstration site of different like gardening and land use techniques like that, and we are goat farmers and things like that. So to me, the ag zoning is a better fit, but obviously you can decide for yourself. So. Have questions for me? Yeah.
Yes, please. Commissioners, any questions for Ms. Nielsen? I do have a question, in fact. Water, I see that on your proposed map, there is no indication of water sources. I read that there is no streams or water courses running through the property, so I assume there is plan to put certain wells or a number of? Or...
Well, actually, we have rights. There is Deep Gulch Creek, and then we also have a spring that they're technically on Forest Service property, but we have written deeded rights to those that should provide adequate water for everything that we want to do. And then we also have a rain catchment pond that's quite large that we currently use for agriculture uses. So.
Okay, that's good. Commissioners, any other questions for Mrs. Nelson? No, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Any further comments from the public regarding this agenda item? And if there's not, we will close public hearing and bring it back to the commission. Thank you.
Staff, is there a requirement for water supply in terms of gallons? I mean, like we've heard for subdivisions, each parcel has to have 3 gallons per minute. In like a commercial project like this one, obviously, you probably need more water, and there's also an agricultural component.
So. The environmental health specialist would provide that requirement and information as part of their permitting for a commercial kitchen and for just general development of the site.
And so it would be up to the applicant to prove that they have
correct
10 gallons a minute or whatever it is.
Yes.
I do have another question. In fact, it says here under the conditions of approval, which is page 12 of the package, number 4, a sign permit, if requested, shall meet requirements for on-site signage. Is that something that comes later in the request, or is this something that can just basically, under agriculture, there's a certain specifications of the size of the signage?
No, we just have general development standards for signs in our zoning ordinance, and so they can't go any bigger than the
system.
Yeah, so I wanted to include that in case they wanted to have a sign, because we didn't really talk about it.
Regarding ag versus ag forest or any other concerns?
Because I'm inclined to go with what the applicant would like.
And I'm the same. I feel the same. And I actually felt that I probably fit a little bit better.
Certainly more forest on the east side of the river as it brought up.
Client decided with applicant agriculture, and being that the parcel to the south is zone ag as well, it doesn't mean if it's ag, if it's approved as ag, it's not, it would not be the only one in its surrounding basically. Anyone have a motion? Any discussion?
I move that we adopt the mitigated negative declaration, finding that on the basis of the whole record before the commission, including the initial study and comments received, that there is no substantial evidence that the project will have a significant effect on the environment, and that the negative declaration reflects the commission's independent judgment and analysis, and approve the rezone from unclassified to agriculture 40-acre minimum, finding the action to be consistent with the overall goals and policies of the Trinity County General Plan, and approve the use permit to allow a six-guest room and a breakfast facility, a one-bedroom residence, employee housing, a small convention meeting room, maximum 20 people, an agricultural building and two outdoor kitchens, subject to the findings of fact and conditions of approval as stated in the staff report.
I'll second that.
There is a motion to approve on behalf of Commissioner Stewart, seconded by Commissioner Matthews. Further discussion, commissioners? Those in favor of the motion presented?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Since Director Rick Tippett is not here, as suggested earlier, we're going to move on to agenda item number 6, which reads variance from required 350-foot cannabis, commercial cannabis setback. Applicant Dixon.
Commissioners, real quick, wanted to point out that all of the variances have the urgency ordinance cited in under background information versus the ordinance that we have in effect now. So if you go in item number 6, go to page 2, first paragraph under background information, it says ordinance 315-823, that's the urgency ordinance. So we'll be correcting those when we do the variances.
Good evening. So this project is located in Sawyer, right off of 299. It is limited due to parcel size, buffers, including a school bus stop, and the neighbor 350-foot setback, and also a Class 1 water surface, the Trinity River, to the west. We did receive a public comment regarding the school bus stop. Our software GIS system had the school bus stop around the bend on 299 from the subject property. I checked with the superintendent of the public schools in Sawyer, and she confirmed that the school bus stops are as they are indicated in Figure 4. Using GIS, we mapped it, and it looks like the applicant's garden is outside of this school bus stop buffer. Staff is recommending approval.
Thank you, Planner Wagons.
So we have a letter from Mr. Scherzer. You know which property the parcel that is?
I have the same question. Is that the parcel that is affected or some other?
Which? A letter from?
From Joshua Scherzer. And he gives a street address as 6 acre Highway 299. Oh.
You know, I don't have the parcel number on that. That came in just the other day, and yeah, I didn't
didn't see that.
It looks like the consultant has a response to that question.
All right, yes, they can address that in public comments.
Thank you.
Any other further questions or clarifications at the moment?
Yeah, I actually have another question. The report says that based on satellite review and a person's site visit, such property does not have any viable alternatives for relocating the cultivation site. But then it goes on to say Cody Smith, code compliance specialist, has reviewed this project and says that due to the size of the parcel, cultivation area could possibly be relocated. Is that referring to the fact that it needed to be relocated from the flood zone?
Actually, I think that code compliance specialist Cody Smith was out there and looked at the site before we found out the bus stops were relocated.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So I think the bus stops prevented from being relocated to where he was staying.
Okay. I just was wondering why that conflict.
No further clarifications at the moment. We're going to open public comment on this item.
Good evening. My name is Deidre Brower with Down River Consulting, and we are helping Mr. Dixon through this process. And as noted, he needs a variance from the property to the east, and that letter of support did come from that neighbor. There was also an additional letter of support from the neighbor to the north of him, who is not affected by it, but is a neighbor that is within 300 feet. As noted, there's not a good place to move the garden. There's, you know, it's really steep when you go down to the river, and there's the bus stop issue. There was one letter of objection in there from a neighbor that he's not within 350 feet, and some of her concerns were, as Scott mentioned, the proximity to school bus stop, which is not the case. He's not too close. And also, she has some concerns about highway safety and traffic on Pony Creek Road, which is the road she lives on. This parcel does not access Pony Creek at all. You know, Mr. Dixon is aware of traffic concerns and, you know, takes them seriously and drives slow and is already obligated under the water board to maintain erosion control and things of that nature. And the property is really clean. He's been enrolled at the water board for 2 years now. There's a nice new house on it. And if you have any additional questions, I am available.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Brown. Anyone else wishing to comment on this particular item? Yeah, there's not, we were closed public comment. Thank you.
From the residence on APN 008-370-29, subject to the conditions of findings of fact and conditions of approval as listed in the staff report.
Is there a second, commissioners?
Oh, I'll second.
Thank you. Motion of approval initiated by Commissioner Stewart, second by Commissioner Matthews. Further discussion? If there's not, we will vote on this. Those in favor of approve of the motion?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Moving on to the next item on the agenda item number 7. Variance from required 350-foot commercial cannabis setback, applicant Channing.
Good
So when reviewing this application, we see that the property is pretty boxed in with the 350-foot residential setback. There's really no viable place or no viable alternative on this property to relocate the garden. As you can see in the pictures, in figure four, the parcel's pretty well screened with fencing, and it's a pretty tidy site. Staff is recommending approval.
One thing on the project evaluation, mm-hmm. It says 16 feet, but I assume that is the 106.
Yes, ma'am.
I have one question on your pictures.
Mm-hmm.
First page of the pictures, it says Wyatt.
Yes, that was a typo also.
Yeah, thank you for that. I wanted to make sure we were looking at the correct. The APN numbers were right, but the name was wrong, so I was wondering.
Any further questions, commissioners, clarifications? That there's not, we're going to open public comment. Those are wishing to address the commission regarding this item, please come forward.
Good evening, Teacher Brower, Down River Consulting. Ms. Chang and her husband purchased this property a couple of years ago and did quite a bit of cleanup on it and put a home on it and have been living in the community of Hayfork there. And it is in the water district. So when they originally signed up for the water board a couple of years ago, it was not an option to sign up for the county at that time. It had been cut out already. But they still continued to go forward, signed up at the water board, prepared the resource protection plan, and then as soon as the water district opened back up, they then began the process of trying to get enrolled with the county licensing. And they did pay for their permit last year as well, even though we were still waiting for the variance. As Scott mentioned, there really is nowhere else on the property. There's nowhere to go that you're not 350 feet away from the neighbor's properties. And I know that she's tried to reach out to her neighbors. There's a language barrier, which makes it kind of difficult, and her sister often helps, but when she's not there, it's hard. So they have, they're on good terms with neighbors, but they were not able to really connect and offer, get the letters of support. Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Brower. Anyone else wishing to address the commission regarding this agenda? Okay.
Good evening. Once again, John Brower from Junction City, and I want to encourage approval of this variance. The applicant really showed a lot of faith in this new unproven system by sticking with the program through that that time of not even being able to participate, but becoming water board compliant and developing a system of best management practices and really buying into the whole program and encouraging approval. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Brower. And that there's no additional comments, thank you. We are now closing public comment.
Well, since I have a comment, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
Since this is in the opt-out area in Hayfork, and since our precedent last time was to not allow that, I'm not inclined to support this.
Not that. They have every right to have this be approved because the Hayfork Water District, the Trinity Water District number one, does not close to cultivation licenses until July 1st.
This is not cultivation, this is a variance.
Yes, it is.
This is a variance,
a variance to allow them to cultivate. It's a variance to allow
I understand
them to
exactly
get
what
their
this is,
cultivation
commission.
License. And they have a right to get this because this is still open.
you. Are you referring in light of the actions taken in our last meeting in terms of opt-out zones of no further development of cultivation activities? Is that what you're...
No, no, no. There was another variance request in the Lewiston opt-out zone.
Yes.
Lewiston was already closed.
This has nothing to do with the date closure. That person had made the date, so the closure open thing is irrelevant. So this has to do with someone who had made the date now coming back and asking for further entitlement.
Can I point of order that there has been approvals of variances in this water district prior as well?
I don't believe that's true under the permanent ordinance. I believe all of those occurred under the urgency ordinance. So my position is that the notion of the opt-outs was to allow farmers already farming to farm, but not extend the entitlements. And this is, not only is this a variance, it's 1, 2, 3, 4 different homes impacted by this. We've also used a large number of homes to as a guiding principle, also in Hayfort, although not in the district, down on Morgan Hill Road, we had to use that same logic. So, in principle, I think that the opt-out, the communities that wanted the opt-outs wanted to not be in the cannabis business. The board allowed, if you will, the term in the paper was grandfathering in of some farmers. That's fine, but this is not just getting cultivation license. This is adding on top of it a variance. So that's my position, as it was in Lewiston, and it's still that I think that the practice ought to be not to extend the growth in the opt-outs. That's the point of the opt-out. But
the Board of Supervisors extended the period when people could apply for cultivation licenses, which includes the ability to apply to request variances for a reason, and that was to allow those people in the Hayfort opt-out area to have the opportunity to grow.
Commissioners, I've given some latitude, but in general, the discussions would be following a motion and a second. So if we could have a motion on the table and a discussion.
I will go ahead and make a motion. I move that we approve the variance to allow reduction of the cannabis cultivation setback from 350 feet to 220 feet for the residents on APN 014-450-10 and 350 feet to 79 feet from the residents on APN 014-100-06. And from 350 feet to 106 feet from the residents on APN 014-100-13, subject to the conditions of approval and findings of fact as listed in the staff report.
Thank you, Commissioner Stern. There's a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Second. Thank you. Discussion. Further discussion?
I mean, I have to say I'm a little concerned the number of structures, how close they are, and there's a new structure, new house being built to the west. It appears to be pretty close to the property line.
That's also my concern. I'm not really that concerned about it being in the opt-out area as much as it's in the middle of the residential neighborhood. And I think I will make a competing motion that we deny the variance based on the fact that there are four houses that are affected and one that's under construction that will be affected, and that we didn't get any letters of approval. We didn't get any letters against it, but also we didn't get any letters of approval. So I'm comfortable with that.
Mr. Fraser has made a motion. Is there a second to his competing motion?
I'll second it.
There's a second. Any further discussion, commissioners?
There are no letters, as the consultant stated, there are no letters of support because of the language barrier. And I think that that's a very reasonable reason, and I don't think that it is incumbent on us to penalize somebody simply because they have a different life.
I don't either. My concern is that this is in the, it's in the middle of the neighborhood. You know what I mean? It's also not incumbent upon us to grant every variance in areas that it doesn't fit. And our job is to try to protect the community also. There are some places where cultivation doesn't fit.
Brady Road has a, areas on Brady Road, this far on Brady Road, have a long history of cannabis cultivation. And the number of premises, if you look, there's another one right up away from it. I mean, they're all over back in there. And the number of residences makes absolutely no difference.
I believe that if the neighbors, with such close proximity, which is 79 feet and 106 feet, if they were truly concerned about the activities going on about the cannabis grow, they should have stated and wrote a letter of opposition.
Absolutely.
I can understand if you're 250, 300 feet away, big screen of trees, you don't know, hear, understand what's going on, that's fine. But at such close proximity,
they know.
If they know what's going on, and if they would have a problem with this, they would have written a letter of opposition.
Absolutely.
Furthermore, I believe that the applicant is within their right to apply for the variance. They are under the July 1st, 2018 deadline, and it is granted to be allowed to exercise a variance if needed to be, if they come under that threshold, that time threshold. I see no reason why this variance should not be approved based on those facts. So, any further discussion, commissioners, before we vote on competing motion first, and then motion Commissioner Stewart has stated? Okay, being that there's none, we're gonna, Commissioner Frazier has motion to deny the variance. Those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
Nay.
Nay. The motion is denied. I believe, is there a need to...
You would move back to the original motion.
Thank you, Council. We move back to the original motion presented by Commissioner Stewart, which is to approve the variance in question. Those in favor of the motion to approve?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed?
No.
No.
Motion carries for approval, 3-2. Next item on the agenda item number 8, variance form required 350-foot commercial cannabis setback. Applicant Cadwell Johnson. Caldwell Johnson.
Applicant is technically in Weaverville, but outside of the opt-out area, up on Ward Plaza Place. The property is confined by slopes running north to south. We did a satellite review and determined that it could not be relocated to another part of the property without still needing a variance. Code compliance specialist Smith reviewed the property and mentioned that it had a large disturbed area and needed an updated plot plan. The applicant did update the plot plan to indicate the new layout. You should have a larger copy of that in front of you. Looks like on page 5 of the staff report there is a typo with the next variance. It's listed Dodson, but that's actually going to be up next. In any case, back to code compliance specialist Smith. He mentions that any tree removal or grading needs to be compliant with CAL FIRE, And due to the parcel size, it cannot move the cultivation area without needing a variance. The applicant was assessed an administrative civil penalty by CAL FIRE. The applicant has resolved all issues with CAL FIRE. They settled and is in full compliance with CAL FIRE standards. We did receive one letter of support from the impacted residents to the west, APN number 24-680-29. No additional comments have been provided to staff. Given that the applicant is in compliance with CAL FIRE standards and provided the updated plot plan, staff recommends approval of the variance.
Mr. Watkins. Commissioners, any questions of technical nature or clarifications on staff's presentation? Being that there's not at the moment, we'll open a public hearing on this item. I'm not wishing to address the commission of this, please come forward. State your name for the record.
Good evening, Dieter Brower. We're representing Mr. Caldwell on this variance, and have also worked with him for water board enrollment and had started the fish and wildlife process for him, and he's working to become fully environmental compliant. I do have the letter from CAL FIRE stating that the matter has been resolved, and there were actually the three neighbors. We've got late, so we've got the one approval that was sent into planning, and then we have another one from the neighbor to the west, I believe, APN ending in 32. As also as Scott stated, there is really nowhere else to move in our property. I'm available for any other questions.
Is that letter available?
Yes.
Questions for Mrs. Brower, commissioners?
Thank you.
Any other public comments regarding this agenda item?
My name is DeAndre Caldwell Johnson. I am the applicant. I thank you all for hearing this matter this evening. I greatly appreciate approval given my life to this. I studied business for the last 8 years, and I came up here with the intention of starting a business in the cannabis industry. All my dollars at this time stay within this community, and given the event that this variance is approved and we can commence cultivation, all the dollars generated by this business will remain in Trinity County. I hope to be a steward of the environment, and I hope to be a member of this community for years to come. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Gumbel.
A question, sir.
Mr. Crabber, could you please return?
Thank you. Have you been in contact with the parcel to the north, the one that we don't have a letter on?
They are here currently, I believe. I have spoken with them verbally, and I do have their verbal approval. I've become very close neighbors with everyone around me, within my immediate vicinity, I would say. I have a good relationship with all my neighbors. They all understand what my aim is up there, and they know that I'm doing the best to preserve the environment as well as this community.
Thank you. Any further questions for Mr. Powell? Thank you. comments from the public? And if there's not, we're closed public comment. Thank you.
I'll make a motion to approve the variance to allow reduction of the cannabis cultivation setback from 350 feet to 320 feet from the residence on APN 024-380-29, from 350 feet to 326 feet from the residence on APN 024-680-30, and from 350 feet to 152 feet from the residence on APN 024-380-32, subject to the conditions of approval based on the findings of fact in our staff report.
I'll second.
Do you have a question? Are these APNs 024380 or 024680?
Motion of approval presented by Commissioner Matthews.
Well, I'll need to amend my motion to reflect the corrected AP and numbers, all with the second series of numbers 680.
I will second the amendment.
Amendment motion presented to Commissioner Matthews, seconded by Commissioner Stewart. Further discussion? If there's not, those in favor of the motion presented?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Next item on the agenda item number 9, variance from required 350 foot commercial cannabis setback. Applicant Dodson.
So the next variance we're taking a look at is in Hayport off of South Meadow Lane. The applicant has relocated the majority of their outdoor cultivation to a new location that's closer to South Meadow Lane, but still outside of all buffers, including the creek that's right there. The applicant did mistakenly have a water bladder within the buffer that you can see in picture 2. But as the amended plans illustrate, that bladder has been relocated outside of the water course setback. Code compliance specialist Dickey has reviewed the project and made the following comments. Did not move the cultivation area to meet the setback requirements. Which is to say that this now is in the best possible spot on the property. We did have one property owner located 1 mile to the south of the applicant's property submit a letter supporting the project, but expressing concern that future neighbors may be hindered by a regulatory framework whereby cannabis cultivation on one lot prompts county authorities to hinder future development opportunities on adjacent lots. I have attempted to contact this property owner and discuss his concerns, but I have not been able to get contact with him. We received another letter from the impacted property owner, and they are in support of granting this variance. Staff recommends approval.
Thank you, Mr. Watkins.
Out there for my 1600, and she did proof of the cultivation area. Greenhouse facilities there were all agreeable to them, so just wanted to add that. And thank you for considering this.
Thank you, Mr. Dodson. Any questions for the applicant?
Justin Hawkins, Hayford. I just wanted to give my, you know, express my, I would like you guys to go ahead and approve the variance from Matt. He's been a great neighbor and just the sort of person we need in the community. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hawkins. Any other comments from the public? We will close public comment. I'll get back to the commission. Thank you.
If I may?
Please do, Commissioner.
I move that we approve the variance to allow reduction of the cannabis cultivation setback from 350 to 168 from the residence on APN 017-440-25, subject to the conditions of approval and findings of fact as listed in the staff report.
I'll second that.
Motion for approval initiated by Commissioner Stewart, seconded by Commissioner Matthews. Further discussion? Being that there's not a vote on that, those in favor of the motion presented?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? He does not. Motion carries unanimously. Next, then, item on the agenda, apparently Director Richter is not here yet. It is 7:53. I believe we are going to move forward without him at the moment. So, item number five, proposed amendment to zoning ordinance allowing for non-storefront retail commercial cannabis license, applicant Trinity County.
Before the Board of Supervisors two times in April, on April 3rd and April 17th, and here at the Planning Commission on April 26th. We needed to bring it back to the Planning Commission for a second time to meet noticing requirements. You did make some revisions when it appeared the last time, and those are incorporated in the version before you, indicated with italics, and they're highlighted. Staff did not have any more input from the time that you left.
Thank you. And thank you for including the italics and highlighted stuff. Very clear. Commissioners, any questions or clarifications before we open it up for public comment? That there's not at the moment we're over public comment on this agenda item. Everyone wishing to address the commission, please come forward, state your name for the record.
Good evening. John Davies, Lewiston. I would like to submit an updated list of residents who are opposed to any type of cannabis activity or businesses within all opt-out areas.
You can make those available to Ruth here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Katie Quinn, Lewiston. I want to thank the commissioners for relooking at this and to making some of the changes. And I would really encourage you to keep these changes as far as where the non-storefront retailers will not be allowed. We would like to see it actually in all of the opt-outs. We don't see Hayfork in here, but can understand that. But we would like to make sure that it's kept out of particularly the Lewiston opt-out and any of the historical areas that are included in the opt-outs in Unionville as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Quinn.
Good evening, Justin Hawkins, Hayfork. I can understand Lewiston residents coming in here and asking for an opt-out on additional cannabis activities, but as a Hayfork resident, I'm here to tell you that we're ready to actually get rid of the Hayfork opt-out zone. It's stifling business in our community. And this is going to pretty much eliminate most of the commercial zone C2 properties in downtown Hayford. So, they come in here, that's their business, I completely understand. I wouldn't go up to Lewiston and tell them that they can do that. But as a Hayford resident, I'm asking that we are allowed all the all the cannabis activities. That's what we want. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hawkins.
Adrian Keyes, also of Hayfork, and geez, Justin just about stole my thunder there, but I couldn't agree more. Hayfork is in need of jobs. Hayfork is in need of development. Hayfork's in need of housing. Anything that we can do to drive this forward, I've gone throughout my community and spoke to as many people as I possibly can. I haven't run into a single person that would, at least to my face, tell me that they would oppose this ordinance or the microbusiness or manufacturing in the Water District. The Water District encompasses almost the entirety of all of our manufacturing commercial districts. If other folks in other neighborhoods in Trinity County are happy with their level of employment, and they're happy with the level of employment in Hayfork, then more power to them. But I can't see how anybody can be happy with the level of employment in this county. And these are things where we can actually build jobs. It's extremely important to our economy, especially in Hayfork. And we're down there fighting very hard to try and drive our town in the right direction and lift it up by its bootstraps and move forward with this and not sit on our heels. Thank you. Sorry if I sound a little bit irritated, but I am.
Thank you, Mr. Keyes.
Terry Myers, Junction City. We're in a bad predicament here, and I think that, me personally, this isn't for me here, but I think there's some people that could really utilize this to stay afloat and survive this. We're in survival mode. This is a transition into this industry has been, difficult for most. Especially for the county planners, supervisors, everybody. State moved the ball around, changed the rules every other day on us. Probably is going to change it some more here. But I think that this is something that a lot of people in this county kind of need to have happen to move forward. I just think continuing to push it down the road is getting difficult for a lot of people. And I think we should probably take a look at it and consider trying to push this through. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lyons. Any other comments from the public?
Yeah, John Brower from Junction City, and once again, I'd like to speak to this item being timely and a really, really gentle baby step into this this retail subject. Our cultivators that have already jumped through all these crazy hoops should absolutely 100% be able to support their existing patient base and know what can be an adult use base. It's fundamental for safe medical access for our region, and I see no real impacts or nuisances that could possibly come from this. If somebody has some nuisances or threats to public safety, I would love to hear them publicly, but I can't think of any. And I think this is very reasonable. There is a huge laundry list of protections built into the state regs regarding retail, especially no storefront retail. This should be a slam dunk. It's absolutely right for our communities. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brower.
Commissioners, thank you for your time. My name is Dave Holliday. I'm in Lewiston. I was always raised, my dad always taught me to live and let live. I think every person has the right to do with their property what they want, right up until the time it negatively affects their neighbors. My wife and I bought our forever home in Lewiston. And I don't think that other folks have the right to jeopardize our quality of life. Not for us, not for our kids, not for our grandchildren. I've seen probably more of this county than maybe a lot of folks in this room. I understand the folks in Hayfork. I understand their opinions and I understand their viewpoints. But I live in Lewiston. And I understand that we contribute differently to this county than other parts do. I live in an opt-out area. And I would encourage you to honor that opt-out area. I don't want to see any cannabis cultivation. I don't want to see storefronts in my area. I don't want to see it negatively impact my property value or my quality of life. No more so than any grower in this county would if I opened up something that negatively impacted their lives. As I used as an illustration to somebody that I was talking to a couple of weeks ago, I said, you have a wife, you have children. I said, you probably wouldn't appreciate it if I opened up a halfway house for sex offenders next to your home, would you?
No.
Probably not. We all have our stories and we all have our feelings as to why we think the way we do about the cannabis industry in this county. It is here. Yes, we have to learn to live with it. But I don't think that other people have the right to move into our neighborhoods where we've opted out of areas. It's not, opt-out areas aren't for everybody, obviously. But in our area of Lewiston, we have opted out of it. And I think that that should be honored. It's our neighborhood, it's where we live, and it's where we chose to make our lives. No more so than it would be fair for me to move into somebody's neighborhood in Salyer or, you know, Southern Trinity and the Dinsmore area or Hayfork and do something that would adversely affect their lifestyle. So I would encourage the board to, or the commission to honor our opt-out areas and not allow the manufacturing facilities in our area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Holliday.
John Letton, Douglas City. Good evening. Thanks for taking the time. I know a little bit about the history of this particular ordinance. It was very, very poorly drafted when it was hurriedly considered by the Board of Supervisors. Fortunately, the decision there was to put it in front of you where it should have been in the first place. It still shows the effect of that poor drafting, but I don't think it would be appropriate to go through and suggest a whole list of edits. I'm going to suggest a couple just so a person who wasn't familiar with it could actually read sense out of it. And those suggestions are like this. I suggest that in section 2B that you craft a definition of non-storefront retail, but do it with the understanding which you have that the land use issue we're talking about is the facility from which a non-storefront business will be run. The ordinance that was drafted reads as if there isn't any such building and you've struggled with it. So anyway, in 2.1b, I put non-storefront retail premises and then maybe put in parenthesis NSF premises and then use that consistently throughout. To illustrate the difficult background that you're struggling with, that now reads, non-storefront retail is defined as the selling and delivery of cannabis and cannabis goods to customers. It's as if that's what the license is for, or that's what the land use issue is. It does go on to say, from a licensed premises. I suggest that you define the premises because that's the land use issue that you're dealing with. There's various terminology is used throughout the, by the way, where is their clock?
Yes, I'm sorry, Mr. Lepton, the clock
We've had technical difficulties.
Okay.
I'm keeping time, so now you have a minute left.
Okay, if you could do that, it would help the stranger read it. It still does contain the really comical statement on page 4, at one eye, non-storefront retailers will not be allowed in certain areas. Non-storefront retailers, that there shouldn't be any such terminology. Those are people. So the way it reads is, people who have cultivation licenses and one of these licenses can't go into Weaverville. it's crazy, and it's not your fault. I expect you to go ahead and pass it, and pass these drafting issues on to the Board of Supervisors where they originated. Let's see. So defined facility, I think there's one area you might want to address, and that is what happens if there is an existing cultivation within the school bus setback. Excuse me. Yeah. It can there be the premises for a non-storefront retail within the setback, I guess is the issue that I'm trying to address. And whether or not there can be delivery to a residence within the setback. That's not addressed.
Thanks. Thank you, Mr. Lewis.
Okay.
Anyone else wish to address on this comment on this agenda item?
Everett Harvey, Weaverville. Wasn't going to get up, but the last talk sort of gelled something at me. The way the ordinance is written, if it were in an urban area, it sounds a little bit like street corner distribution. It's not very well defined. It talks not about facilities, basically everything you said. I'm going to double on that.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey. Any further comments? If there's not room to close public comment, thank you for your comments. Absolutely.
I've given this some thought over the last couple weeks about the opt-out areas, and I have a complete understanding of both sides. Why there's a desire for that, I respect everybody, what they're saying. But one of the things I've learned as director over time is that you have to ensure that if you have an activity going in on the spot, that you have the ability what I'd say is, in this particular field, is provide the opportunity for compliance. We do allow, through the opt-out, which are very restrictive rules, properties to develop and cultivate but if they create impacts, we also mitigate those through the time and through our process. It concerns me that sometimes when you restrict things or do things before you know the whole picture, and this program is new. I mean, it's an unfortunate thing that we're dealing with, but it comes out. But when you restrict things or allow things, there's always that situation of unexpected return, and that you might create a situation where you have a problem. One of my concerns is that in the opt-out areas, you can say you're allowed to cultivate, but you're not allowed to do anything as far as distribution. And one of the things I've learned in this program is to be quite candid with you. If you don't give them a route, they push the route. And so that's why I get back to the word for opportunity for compliance is one of the things I think we always need to look for in these types of things, to make sure that we have that route for people to be compliant and do what they're supposed to do. And, you know, one of the one of the things I will say about this canvas program is, and I'll attest to it, to just simply, you look at the cultivation ordinance, it's been modified probably, I think, on the fifth time going around. Four times. That allows, that when we go and we find the things, when we put our finger on what the problems are, we do go back and mitigate those problems to try to make sure that the neighbor is not impacted. And that's very important, that the neighbor is not impacted. But in these situations, I look at what is potentially the biggest impact outside of the cultivation already happening is going to be, for me, it's traffic. It's going to be people that are coming and going to deliver a product, $3,000 or less. So my recommendation would be to look at that as a finding that if you were to want to put further restrictions in opt-out areas, that you look at restricting the thing that we know is going to be a problem, which one thing I see is traffic, as I mentioned. So kind of look towards that, but I just also want to remind you that if we do restrictions in opt-out, we have to make findings. And so we'd like to hear what you guys want to go on. So that was kind of a rhetorical answer to your questions.
So you're saying that if we wanted to approve this as presented to us, we would need to adopt findings that support the restriction in the opt-out areas. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
If you are going to say no, if you say you can cultivate there but you cannot manufacture or sell there, I'm just saying that in order to do that, you want to make sure that you're very definitive as to why you do that for the record, so that you can show why we are saying we don't want to have it in that particular area.
Can we get an opinion from council on what that would mean? That's not something we've done before, I don't think, having to come up with findings. So I don't know how we do that on the spot.
Yeah, so ultimately, when you place a restriction or you make a denial, you're making specific findings as to why you've done that. Even if you don't necessarily list those specific findings, staff is including those in the record as to how you made your decision.
You mean like the general finding of nuisance, that cannabis can be a nuisance or something like that?
Correct. And I think, and Rick can correct me if I was wrong, I'm wrong because I was briefed on this. I think the issue is that some of these properties are already approved for the cultivation of cannabis in this area. And I think what Rick is stating is in these smaller farms that creates the issue of the ability to legally move it and distribute it off of the property. And I think his point was you have these properties that are already licensed for that. And at this point, we don't have any central locations for manufacturing, so I think that was his point. And so it's to facilitate for those in those restricted areas that have already been granted licenses.
So do you see that we would actually need to craft some findings tonight, or are there findings that staff has that support this ordinance presented to us?
I think you could suggest findings and have staff prepare those for you, or you could make the findings on the record tonight and staff would codify those in.
And we could we not suggest that certain areas, such as the Trinity County Waterworks District number 1, which by the way is A4, not be included as be included as an exception and not eliminated.
That's certainly a different issue.
But so it eliminates the needs for findings
for that area. But I think the findings would apply to all areas, or potentially.
Just to clarify, you're talking about the sections E, F, G, and H that have been lined out.
Yeah. No, specific. She's talking about C.
No, I'm talking about Judy, I'm talking about.
This lined out.
The lined out area.
So you keep the exception.
You would keep the exception.
Okay, or you could just strike, couldn't you just strike it from the previous paragraph? Where it says with them. Either way, number different ways you could do it.
However, it is most effective to leave it in and not eliminate it from the ability then to have non-storefront retail.
So if I understand the logic here, the logic is that someone who is growing in an opt-out area.
Who is licensed.
Under the.
Yeah, who is licensed, which is a very restricted group right now.
And you're arguing that they can't find a distributor, a licensed distributor, to do the distribution for them, who would take care of testing. I mean, they can't find a retail outlet that could sell for them outside the opt-out area. That's what you're saying. Is it so that the cultivator himself has to do this in the opt-out area? Right. Today, cultivators can deliver through a distributor who has a license anywhere in the state. And what I'm hearing is that the cultivators in the opt-outs can't find one, so they have to become their own.
Well, it's, and I'm going to turn it over to Leslie because she knows this one better than I do, but the part is the processing and getting it ready and then
you mean trimming, processing
right,
product?
Yeah, right now is. I'll turn over to Leslie.
Distributors don't do that.
First off, in answer to your question, they could find a distributor. Most likely, yes, they could. But they want to have that ability to be able to do the delivery themselves without having to rely on an outside distributor. If they did self-transport, they could also be their own distributor.
Transport only.
Well, so they could kind of close, it allows, if they can do non-storefront retail, transport only will not allow them to go to retail, but this would allow them to take it to retail without having to go to a full distributor.
So the board has already established findings in the cultivation ordinance. There's a preamble to that. There's findings about this being a nuisance. Not only is it in the cultivation ordinance, it's in the personal grow ordinance, declaring it a nuisance. So apparently it's a nuisance. And they've also found that in the high density areas, I've forgotten the term, but it's a big nuisance. Essentially, it's a big nuisance in the areas where you have high density populations. Large, and they drew boxes and they said those are the opt-out areas. And in the areas of high density, we don't want to have this going on. Now, we will grant an exception for cultivators. And the principle was they were being grandfathered in, but I understand dates have moved, and so people can run out and get them, even if they're not being grandfathered in, they can go out and get one. Okay. But that was the intent of that, was to allow people who are already cultivating to do that. Now, and we've got stacks of letters and people saying, please don't grow the business in the opt-out area.
And that's fine in their area.
Excuse me, Commissioner, if I might. So the notion is that growing the business in the opt-out areas is counter to what the people wanted in the opt-out areas. Whether some opt-out areas want to opt out of being an opt-out, okay, that's a different discussion, and that's a fine discussion, yeah. But in the areas where the folks in the opt-out don't want a spread of the business in the opt-out, I don't understand that because we grandfathered in this grower and the grower wants to be his or her own distributor, we need to allow that. That one's lost on me, that bit of logic, because the whole structure of, if you may recall, when MRSA first came out, all of this vertical integration was not in there. You couldn't do all these things. I think you had a maximum of two license types that you could have. Prop 64 kind of relaxed that a little bit, but the whole notion back when MRSA was making this stuff legal was you were going to have to go find a distributor somewhere to do your distribution. That was built into the whole model. That got relaxed, but we have findings that say it's a problem to do this in the opt-out. The board has established those findings. So that, you know. we have the public showing up saying, yep, we agree with that. And I don't find, I'm lost on the logic that says because someone is cultivating, we need to allow them to do manufacturing, distribution, and retail. And I don't know what else you're asking for, but those are the three I've heard tonight.
Well, just abbreviated, it's we allow process of the product that they have, or that they have grown.
So that's part of the ag process. Is it wrong, or is trimming and all that part of the agricultural part of the business pre-distributor? So that is the processing. In fact, at one point, it made sense to me we have centralized processing facilities, you know, so that they put, you know, build a warehouse and trim everybody's product in there. Maybe that's a good idea, too. I mean, processing may be something you care about and look at separately, but I'm simply, the logic is escaping me on doing this anyhow. And I think we have findings in the cultivation ordinance that we can borrow. And it speaks directly to the opt-out definitions. You know, these are the high-density population areas. It's a nuisance. We're going to allow cultivation because we've grandfathered. The idea was these people had already invested. I get that. Okay. We've got that at code. It's the expansion of it that we're hearing directed with.
May I speak now?
Yes, please, Commissioner Stewart. Thank you.
I'm fine with Lewiston, Trinity Center, Coffee Creek not being part of this. If you can find reasons for it, if you think of such a huge list of that they shouldn't be able to distribute their own product, that the people that have been grandfathered in, that's fine. But the Hayfork area still is accepting new licenses. All those people who are currently cultivating and those people are being granted new licenses should be able to have access to all other manufacturing, distribution, micro business, whatever. Because it's not really an opt-out area. At this point, it's an opt-in area. People are opting in to it. Because they have until July 1st.
Because I am swayed by the action and organization the Lewiston community has taken in protecting what they feel are their inherent rights.